Welcome to Druggy Nation. We're the bridge between everything pharmacy and pop culture. And now, let's check in with your connect and America's favorite pharmacist, Emmanuel Vogueron.
All right. I started recording now, Melissa.
Okay.
All right. Testing, testing. 1, 2, 3. You already know what it is. I'm coming live from the DMV, which is DC, Maryland, Virginia. More specifically, hood ass Baltimore, Maryland, aka Crime City. It's a charm city, but it's really Crime City. It's America's favorite pharmacist, Emmanuel Vogueron. And I'd like to welcome a very special guest in the building. Her name is Melissa. Now, if you've listened to my previous audio episodes, you'll know that when I intro my guest, I always say how we know each other and how we met. So Melissa is a recovering meth head, right, Melissa?
Absolutely.
I remember I saw her at my pharmacy one day trying to steal a bunch of Sudafed, and she got called by security guys. And I told her she had to do my podcast for her freedom, and here she is.
Do I get the Sudafed?
Or the truth could be she's my girlfriend's friend, and we actually met at a show, at a medieval show, with horses and knights fighting, kind of like Game of Thrones, and we had fun. I got the idea to do an episode with her. So one of these stories is true. You pick, okay, guys? You decide which is true. I'm going with the meth head story. If you're a first-time listener, welcome to the conversation here at Drug E Nation. Now, as a pill popping nation, this is the number one platform to talk about the role drugs play in our society and everyday lives. The only pharmacy podcast worth listening to, right?
Absolutely.
We have an open dialogue about our pill popping nation, whether it's prescription-wise, recreational, or illegal, and how drug use in America affects all of us. Nobody's immune to that. So either personally, whether it's individually or family or friends, and within our society. So welcome to episode 6, Six God. All right, so now, Melissa, we all may know, right, someone suffering from a mental health disorder, right?
Yeah.
Or going through it ourselves, whether it's anxiety, anger issues, schizophrenia, or depression. Especially in this climate we're in the United States these days, mental health seems like a hot topic of discussion, right?
Yeah, absolutely. It's kind of endemic.
Isn't it everywhere you see it all the time, right?
Yeah.
It's like, not like taboo anymore, like before, right? It's like pretty accepted.
People speak to talk really openly about it. Yeah. I was talking to a friend the other day and I was like, you know,
I don't have any friends. What do you mean? What friends?
I
have no friends.
When you make meth, you need to have a group of people.
That's very true.
It's really tricky.
It's hard by yourself to make it.
Yeah.
Right?
This one new chemistry. So I'm like, we're friends, you know. But I was like, it's kind of true that, like, to a certain extent, everybody kind of struggles with, like, the depression, anxiety thing.
Right.
And it's a really big deal now, so.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, like you said, we all feel angry or sad or depressed sometimes, mm-hmm. or get a little anxious in certain situations. Maybe it's part of your character, your nature, stuff like that, the environment you're in. The point is, this topic seems to be creeping out of the taboo shadows and into the mainstream, at least from what you see in media, whether it's news reports or movies or music. I remember last year, the song by Logic, the rapper.
Oh, yeah.
He had that song, that 1-8-something-something song with, who was in it? With Khaled and stuff for, like, suicide prevention?
Yes,
like Hotline, right?
Every, like, all, for the first time on YouTube, mm-hmm. people weren't fighting about Nazis. Like, they were actually like, no, this is really affecting. And, like, people really appreciated what he put. I freaking love that song.
Yeah, like, it's a great song.
It is.
It's a great song.
Yeah.
I mean, Logic, you know, I used to like Logic a lot as a rapper, but it's okay now. But I appreciated that song. That's a nice song.
Yeah.
It really, and it goes, too. It's a good song, too. A good flow. So I think it's a good song. So it also depends on the culture, I think, because, right, for example, I mentioned before my background, I'm Nigerian, right? So all this mental health stuff, right, is still seen as nonsense and taboo, at least with the older generation of Nigerians or really immigrant culture, kind of. For the most part, an African immigrant culture. I can't speak for all immigrant culture. But I think my generation, like 35 and younger, right, we don't look at it as taboo. I can talk about cultural differences forever. But today, I want to focus on depression in America and what we're going to do as a society and how we're coping with our mental health. And don't worry, I'll try not to make you depressed after this episode. We'll try to have some fun too, right?
Yes.
Maybe with some dope information, because remember, the point of this podcast is to entertain as well as inform, okay? Mm-hmm. To keep your attention. I mean, but last episode, I don't know if you heard it or not, last episode we did on party drugs, so we can do a little depression on this too, okay, guys? So we can relax, guys.
Yeah, and one of them is a party drug, the alternative treatment for depression. So
okay, nice, nice. We'll talk about that too.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So today's topic is on depression. But first, I want to ask, why do you think more and more Americans are depressed? Like, I can answer for myself. I know why I'm depressed.
Yeah.
All I got to do is look at my student loans. And I'm instantly depressed after that.
Yeah.
But what do you think? Like, more and more American, is it like we just talk about it more now? It's like less taboo. It was always depression. It was always existed in America.
It's so complicated.
Isn't it?
Yeah. And the financial sector seems to be doing swimmingly. So, you know, that obviously contributes to it. But no, I think there's a lot of different factors. I think intergenerational trauma is real. And I think
intergenerational trauma. What is that?
Basically, like the intergenerational transmission of trauma through generations.
Oh, gotcha. Like, what's your dad or whatever, like uncle, some of that experience can get transferred. You like that? It made the makeup of them genetically and stuff like that too.
Actually,
that
could get, genetically too, and through behavior. We're finding that more in science, which is like super fascinating.
Oh yeah, before we do, let's mention like don't say where you work at, but what do you do as a living? Actually,
I am a research assistant with your girlfriend.
And a meth head too, but go ahead.
I mean,
keep going.
Where do you think I get the other components? It's very, very accessible. Now we work at the Behavioral Pharmacology Research Unit at Johns Hopkins.
Nice. So
I know it's
she's a smarty. Smarty.
Hey,
Johns Hopkins. They wanted me to come. I said, no, I'm good. Anyways, so let me give you a little overview on depression first, and then we're gonna dive into how different therapies affect our depression. Now, depression, as defined by the APA or American Psychiatric Association, is a common and serious medical illness that negatively affects how you feel, the way you think, and how you act. Now, depression causes feelings of sadness and or a loss of interest in activities you once enjoyed. Think of everything fun you do now. Think about that being taken away from you. So it's a really big deal. Mm. It can lead to a variety of emotional and physical problems that can decrease a person's ability to function at work and at home. Fortunately, it is also treatable. You know, depression is the major mental health disorder in the United States. It is responsible for 99% of mental illnesses. When I found that stat, I was like, wow, 99%?
That's nuts. That's insane. Like, that's crazy.
Why not 100? What is that 1%? What is that other 1% doing?
Probably. There's schizophrenia and like all that other stuff.
It's like, good Lord. And it affects more than 18 million adults each year.
Yeah.
And then due to that, 41,000 people take their own lives each year as a result of living with undiagnosed or untreatable depression. That means someone turns to this last resort every 13 minutes. That's crazy.
It's like very...
I like this stat because it gives you like more of an idea of like how prevalent it is. And like, it's not just a certain group of people like experiencing it. Like, everybody goes through it in some varying like degree or form, right?
Absolutely.
So another stat I found was in 2015, about 16.1 million adults aged 18 and over had a minimum of one depressive episode in the previous year, right? Mm. Depression happens to children too. It's about 1% in preschool aged children. You're probably like, wait, these little babies are getting depressed too? Maybe didn't get their fruits or milk.
Yeah, and also I think like where you live can also affect that. I mean, we live in Baltimore.
Yeah.
And I mean, a lot of times when you grow up in difficult environments,
sure,
like everything from the physical environment to, you know, the families, the crime rate and stuff, like that can really have an impact on kids.
Oh, absolutely.
We actually found in the other lab that I worked in an educational intervention lab that kids felt more safe inside of their schools than they did in their neighborhoods.
Oh yeah.
You know, so
absolutely.
And it's so staggering when you see that, you're like, they're so small, like, you know.
Yeah. And speaking of New Jersey, off camera talked about New Jersey, but I saw this news story also on CBS the other night. I don't know if it was 60 Minutes or not, but they actually had to do an after school thing on the weekends in Newark, New Jersey, because it was safer to be there. Like Friday night, they'll have the kids stay in the school at nighttime till like whatever time to have the parents pick them up later on. And I do it through the whole, I don't know if there's the whole weekend, but I know it's at least Friday night, maybe Saturday as well too.
Like,
and have the children be there just to avoid them going back to where they live. Can you imagine growing up in that environment? Of course I'd be depressed.
Yeah.
So another stat, 2% in school-age children go through depression, 4.7% with teenagers, and pre-pubertal children, that's ages 10 to 13, for those that don't know what pre-pubertal means, depression occurs in boys and girls at an equal rate. So generally, depression in men and women has the highest rates if you're between 25 to 44 years old. So we're both right in that age group right now.
Yeah.
I'm 44, but black don't crack. So you're more likely to experience severe depression as you get older. When you got that house mortgage and kids you need to take care of. I can see that.
Damn.
Taxes, depression also affects about 20% of adults aged 65 and older. that could, I think I'm speculating, but that could be related to like, I'm about to die soon. So I'm
putting your body just gets crappy.
Yeah, exactly. Health problems come up and you're like, you're sad. So I can see that a lot. Like easy to see that when you're that old, like you can definitely see that, you know?
Yeah.
I could be speculating, but I think that's what it is.
Yeah.
Depression affects an estimated 1 in 15 adults. That's 6.7% in any given year. And 1 in 6 people will experience depression at some time in their life. That's 1 in 6. That's not. Yeah.
That's like the top.
Like 1 in 6. Like 6 people. If you know 6 people, one of them is gonna go through depression. But
another thing to take into consideration is a lot of people don't know or they won't. Like if they're being asked to report, they won't say it. Especially like men are socialized not to talk about their feelings. So like, it's probably more than that.
I think it's more in men. I really do. Because think about it, like. Obviously, we're getting to be less of a patriarchal society. I mean, a little bit, not too much. Un poquito. But I'm saying, you think about how men feel like they have to be all macho or feel like, you know, I don't have to go to the doctor or feel like I have to take care of a whole family by myself, either the breadwinner in the family.
Yeah.
Obviously, you have more shared responsibilities now as far as that is concerned in this day and age. But still, I think that's still, it's just imprinted in a man's psychology when they're from a little kid, it's from their dad's talking to them to when they're older and what they're seeing, like the media movies, and it's just pressure. So I think a lot of men go through that. We just don't talk about it with our friends, our boys and stuff. And that's why therapy is very important. But that's another discussion for therapy.
Oh, absolutely.
A whole different discussion. But anyway, like you said before, ladies are more likely than men to experience depression, but I think that's for different reasons.
Sure.
Some studies show that 1/3 of women will experience a major depressive episode in their lifetime. But that can also be due to women reporting, like you said, their emotional state, and men feel like they can't show vulnerability.
Exactly, more emotional expressivity, yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Depression don't discriminate, y'all, all right? Mm-hmm. Whether you're poor or you're Jeff Bezos, I mean, although he's about to be depressed, losing half his money,
yo. Oh, yes. You probably shouldn't have taken pictures.
Yeah. Oh. You took pictures? Oh, what an idiot. Come on, Jeff. You're smarter than that. Send a drone. Anyways, What are some risk factors for depression, right? You talked about it earlier, the biochemistry of the brain, genetics, right?
Yeah.
The environment you grew up in and you're around and also your personality. So I find it interesting. Like people with low self-esteem that are easily stressed out and have a pessimistic outlook are more likely to be depressed, which makes sense.
Yeah.
Bodies that equate low self-esteem, I could lead to different things, but just automatically, like you're like way higher risk for depression with low self-esteem, which is like, ugh.
Yeah. Yeah,
yeah, I don't know.
More self-consciousness, kind of attributing, like, everything is, like, your fault. And it's interesting, like, some of the alternative treatments we're going to talk about is kind of hopeful because it talks about neuroplasticity. Like, just because you're born that way doesn't mean your brain will end up
that way. Yeah, exactly. So there's hope, guys.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
right? There's hope.
Yeah.
But anyways, like, enough of this definition and stuff. If you want to learn more about a specific type of depression, just go to the APA's website and look at the DSM-5 categories, okay? I don't know if you're on Twitter or not, Melissa, but just a couple of days ago, the hashtag was #HowIFightDepression on Twitter.
I saw that, right?
It was trending. It means it's one of the most popular like topics Americans will talk about that day. Well, that's what a trending topic means, guys, if you're not on Twitter. Twitter's the shit. You should all go on Twitter. Like, I love Twitter. But I mean, that should put a little understanding of how mainstream mental health is now. It's a trending topic on Twitter. All right. So that's really interesting.
Self-care
when I mentioned that.
Is like amazing.
Oh, self-care is like it's the wave right now. It's the wave. As the kids like to say, it's the wave.
Yes.
It's lit. All right. So in this episode, we're gonna talk about meditation and depression, CBD and depression, psychedelics, particularly magic mushrooms or psilocybin and depression. I actually mentioned psychedelics, which was psilocybin in a previous audio. So I think it was audio 3.
Yeah.
If you want to go back, you heard that one, right?
It was a good one, right?
Yeah, that's really good. I had fun on that one. So go back and check that out if you haven't listened to that. Talk about probiotics and your gut bacteria in relation to depression.
Yep.
We're going to mention ketamine and depression, ECT therapy, which is electroconvulsive therapy and depression, and insulin and depression. So it's a bunch of stuff. We're going to only focus on the big takeaways, the meat of it, all right, with each topic.
Yes.
So I'm going to talk about CBD on an entirely different episode in the near future. So look out for that. That's a totally different topic by itself. But like I said, we're going to mention a little bit with depression on this episode. Okay, first, let's start with meditation and depression. So I was looking up the stuff, whatever, and I found like doctors at Harvard. Mm-hmm. Affiliated with MGH, which is Mass General Hospital from my hometown of Boston.
Oh, sweet.
Boston, stand up. They do research on things like how the brain reacts to meditation when someone is depressed. Mm. Meditation and depression. They found that meditation has been found to change certain brain regions that are specifically linked with depression. So stress and anxiety are major triggers of depression, and meditation can actually alter your reaction to those feelings. So the idea is that meditation trains the brain to achieve sustained focus and to return to that focus when negative thinking and emotions and physical sensations try to take over, right?
Yep.
I don't want to get too sciencey, but there's two main regions in the brain. The medial prefrontal cortex and the amygdala, right? Which is like the fight or flight response area,
yep,
where the stress hormone cortisol is chilling at.
Yep.
So those two brain regions work off each other to cause depression, right? Mm-hmm. The MPC, the medial prefrontal cortex, gets worked up, reacting to stress and anxiety. And the fear center, which is in the amygdala, right, response leads to a spike in the cortisol levels, which is a stress hormone, mm-hmm, to fight a danger that's only in your mind. So research has found that meditation helps break that connection between these two brain regions,
yep,
right? And so when you meditate, you're better able to ignore the negative sensations of stress and anxiety, which is why, in general, stress levels just fall when you meditate in general. Do you meditate? I like meditation.
I have been meditating every day for the past year. Like, I love meditation.
Oh, really?
Yeah, we actually have a meditation group at work.
Uh-huh.
And we'll meditate silently for 15 minutes. I quit smoking using meditation.
Congratulations on that.
Thank you very much.
Only meditation? Smoking? Yeah. What?
Yeah. I have been smoking since I was 11. So
wait, time
I
rewind. 11?
Yeah. Like, how? I had my first cigarette when I was like, well, because I watched my mom be stressed out.
Okay.
And then when she smoked a cigarette, she calmed down. I'm like, oh, I guess that works. And that,
like,
so,
you say, intergenerational.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like,
oh,
I
wow.
didn't start like smoking consistently until I was 18, but like, meditation actually helped me quit. And I do it every morning, and I really like it a lot.
How do you do that? Because I want to get better at actually meditating in the morning. And, like, do you, like, put music on? Or is it, like, 15, 20 minutes every morning? Like, how's your morning, if you don't mind me asking, like, your morning process?
So when I wake up,
yeah,
usually the first thing that I do is meditate most mornings when I'm not getting distracted.
But, word.
There's actually an app. I feel like this is like a shameless plug, but there's an app called Headspace.
I know the app. Yeah. I've heard about it. No.
It's awesome.
Yeah.
I had actually paid for it for 2 years and never used it.
Mm-hmm.
And then I started using it, and I just put it on. Like, they have different modules and stuff. And I started out with the guided, and now I do unguided.
Nice.
It really, like, it does kind of change your reactivity to things. You can actually experience it. You're still experiencing the sensation, like,
yeah,
when something stressful occurs, but it's like, instead of it being this like acute spike, it's like, and then you kind of just go down. So like, I read the research, and I don't know if it's like a placebo effect, but I'm kind of like, I'm actually a little bit of a calmer person now. You know, I don't feel
I
need a cigarette like every time I get stressed out. So I'm a huge proponent of meditation.
That's super cool to use meditation to actually stop smoking. Like, that's like super legit.
And now at work, my job is to give other people cigarettes because that's
that's part of the job. Yeah, yeah.
Of course. But I think that meditation can really benefit anybody. And I think something as simple as like using a timer is awesome. Like, I'm a huge proponent of meditation for people. And like, also, I don't know if anybody wants like Headspace coupons and stuff. Like, there's like Planet Fitness. You can get a month free. And Johns Hopkins, I think, offers like a month free of the Calm app. So you could hit up Jenny for that. Like,
nice. That's good. That's a good plug right there.
Yeah.
It's always good to help people out with that.
And to kind of add, I just wanted to give this
information ahead. Add
to
some
you,
more. Yeah.
There was a 2017 Swiss study, because you can't study acid.
Love the Swiss. What up, Swiss?
They're great. Like,
Swiss chocolate. All day,
Swiss
baby.
Swiss chocolate, LSD.
They got expensive ass watches over there, and everything there's expensive. I was in Switzerland. When I went there, like, during a Euro trip, like, years ago.
Oh, God.
And I went to the McDonald's for the dollar menu. It's like $3. That's a dollar menu, okay? It's not a dollar for the dollar menu at McDonald's.
They have, like, gold.
It's like, I'm like, how much? I spent more money in, like, 2 days in Switzerland than I did, like, in a week in, like, Amsterdam, something like that. It's so much money. But anyways, yeah.
it was, like, the financial epicenter of the world.
Yeah.
In Switzerland, for some reason, they're allowed to do LSD research. And they found that administration of LSD, the two brain regions that you mentioned, because I had the exact same information, it reduced activity in those two brain regions. And they think that...
That's what LSD?
Yeah.
Okay.
And they think that psychedelics kind of have a similar effect on the brain that meditation does. It's really weird. There's this paradoxical expansion of consciousness while reducing overall brain activity. It's like freaking awesome.
Oh, wow. You said paradoxical. That's a smart word. I like that.
Yeah. Paradox.
Smarty.
My rap name, Paradox.
That's your rap name, Paradox?
Yeah.
I gotta get my rap name. At the end of this episode, I have a rap name. Okay, guys,
yes.
Don't worry.
So
another way meditation helps the brain is by protecting the hippocampus. Not hippopotamus, hippocampus, which is a brain area involved in memory. So one study discovered that people who meditated for 30 minutes a day for 8 weeks increased the volume of gray matter in the hippocampus, which is a good thing because the larger the area, the better, right? Mm-hmm. And other research has shown that people who suffer from recurrent, which is like always having depression all the time, recurrent depression, tend to have a smaller hippocampus. So if you have a smaller hippocampus, you're more likely to have depression and recurrent depression. So yeah. Guys, it's all in your head.
Yeah, literally.
All right, so next up, let's talk about CBD and depression. I love CBD. I was in Boston. Me and Jenny were in Boston this past weekend, you know, to see the family, all that good stuff. And we're walking down Newbury Street. And then we saw a restaurant that had, it's like a bookstore slash restaurant. So, oh, this is interesting. We walked in there, whatever. And it was new, like smack dab on the menu. It's new. They offer CBD in your any drink you have.
She
like
sent me that.
Coffee, hot chocolate. And you know, I'm thinking like, oh, they're about to put a little splash of CBD, make you think like you have CBD in there. No big deal. Like, it's not going to have any kind of, it's not going to be strong. I mean, when I tasted that hot chocolate, it tasted like marijuana leaves.
Hey.
I mean, it was strong. I was like, oh, shit.
I'm hungry.
Really put some CBD in this bad boy. Oh, no, they put CBD in that hot chocolate. For real, for real.
Mm.
So I think you're going to see that more in different restaurants now. People put in CBD. Oh, they're offering, I guess, CBD in their drinks and, like, chocolate and coffee and stuff like that. So, like,
in restaurants, look out for that. Hot and chocolate, like, is that good? Like, just mixing weed and chocolate?
Oh, like the hot chocolate, like, how it tasted to me was when I had the first sip. First, you feel the, you know, the sweetness of the chocolate, right?
Yeah.
The hot chocolate. And then the after effect was like the little, not bitter, but like, you know, the marijuana leaves. Like a little, it's like eating a leaf, a plant. It's a little bitter, like after effect taste. But overall, it was delicious. Like, we finished that and I felt really good afterwards because it's like to help you with, you know, calm, being calm, help with anxiety. I have a friend that works out a lot in Boston. Shout out to you, homie. I saw him too when I was in Boston. I don't say his name, whatever. But anyways, when he works out, so he needs something to like help with the pain and aches and stuff. So he uses CBD oils
right
to help
on,
with
yeah.
that. So CBD has a lot of good effects. But I want to talk about CBD and depression.
Yes.
So we've all heard about CBD. We all heard about CBD at this point, right? If you want to learn more, there's actually a new documentary on Netflix called Weed the People. W-E-E-D, the people.
It's That's
on
so Netflix. Funny.
So check that out. Yeah, or just Google it. So CBD is more of the medicinal therapeutic part of the plant, while the THC helps you go crazy.
Yeah.
And help you channel your inner Wiz Khalifa. So cannabis oil is the concentrated liquid extract of the marijuana plant, cannabis sativa. Mm-hmm. If you're wondering why it's legal, well, CBD products that don't contain THC fall outside of the scope of the USDA, right? The DEA, the Drug Enforcement Agency.
Yep.
Right? So, which means the CBD products are legal to sell and consume as long as they do not have THC. And that's really the main reason why CBD products, including CBD oil, are becoming more socially acceptable and popular. In 2016, Forbes actually reported that CBD products are expected to be a $2.2 billion industry by 2020.
Damn.
All I gotta say about that is let those people that are in jail for selling those little bags of weed for serving years, life sentences in jail for weed. Let them out now because it's an industry now. It's big. It's mainstream. I don't know why they're still in prison for that bullshit. But anyways.
Status offense is
that's
bullshit.
Like, it's yeah. so offensive to see people making so much money off of this and the people are in jail like just suffering because like, I'm like, what?
No.
I sold some weed. I'm in jail. You selling weed over there? You're making money? Billions? Oh, let me out of here. Let me show you how to really do this. let's answer a couple questions on CBD, okay? Is CBD addictive? What do you think, actually, is CBD addictive?
No, it's not psychoactive.
It's not, yeah.
No, it's not the psychoactive component of marijuana.
Exactly.
Although, I mean, I think technically any substance could be psychologically
that's
addictive.
That's why I hate these questions like this.
It's very,
anything can be addictive.
Yeah.
What I do every day? I do certain things every day. I have to do it every day. That could be considered an addiction, right?
Yeah.
But it's a good thing you do, so it's not considered taboo as the word addiction.
Yeah.
I don't know, but like everything could be addictive. I drink water every day. Is that addictive? What are you talking about? Like,
no, you know what? That's funny. You should think. So schizophrenics apparently have like this compulsion towards ice water.
Oh,
like,
word?
So they're like it's. I was a really weird like thing that I had read like a while ago where like they kind of like compulsively sip ice water. Like it's something that's very like
with ice in it or just ice water,
ice
really cold.
It. Oh, yeah. It's really weird.
It's not like pregnant women always eating ice, whatever. If
that's or
pregnant.
Pickles.
Yeah.
There's exactly. I think like so biochemically addictive, probably not, but like. Psychologically, hell yeah.
I think everything can be psychologically addictive.
I agree with that totally,
1,000%.
Yeah.
So the World Health Organization, or the WHO, says that CBD is not addictive and it has no potential for abuse or dependence, mainly because CBD, like you said, does not contain any addictive substances. Yeah. In contrast to THC and some other cannabinoids that contain THC, which is the really addictive component of it. Mm-hmm. Is CBD safe?
The fact that it got through FDA regulations, I'm going to go out and say, yeah, like, yup.
Yeah.
Like, with something as, like, controversial as marijuana, I know that the motherfuckers were like, listen, if anything goes wrong, even with one of them, y'all are out. You're not going to do this. Now it's like a $2.2 billion industry. So I'm pretty sure that they're doing okay in that regard.
Absolutely. So. You're right about that. So CBD has a relatively low toxicity. So it's safe with little potential for adverse effects. And CBD was found to have no effect on fetal development, which is important, and other bodily functions. So generally, CBD does not
produce... Safe for pregnant ladies?
Yeah, it's safe for pregnant ladies. So you can use CBD when you're pregnant, absolutely. So CBD does not produce the adverse effects seen with THC and other psychoactive cannabinoids, but just don't mix it with other drugs, obviously. You know what I mean? Just don't mix it up.
Yeah.
But how does CBD help with depression now? So, yeah, what do you think about that? Because, like, what I found out was, like, our bodies naturally produce cannabinoids, right, called endocannabinoids or the endocannabinoid system.
Endogenous.
ECS, right? Yeah. So we already have that naturally in us, you know?
Yep.
And that helps to regulate several functions of the body, like mood, pain, sensation, sleep, appetite, all that good stuff. Now, these endocannabinoids bind to specific receptors in the brain and increase the effect of a neurotransmitter called serotonin, which is involved in improving mood and reducing stress levels. So that's how CBD can have a positive effect if you have depression, okay? Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
You find that out too?
Yeah, and there's that, and then like the like secondary pathway, which will go in, it'll kind of link to the probiotics thing that you're going to go into, how like inflammation and inflammatory disorders can be linked with depression. So the idea that CBD can treat those inflammatory disorders and it could be a secondary effect for some people, like helping with their depressive symptoms.
Oh,
like
no, absolutely.
It's cool. It can be like a double whammy.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah.
So you take CBD oil, but I want to know, and people want to know, what's the dose, bro? CBD oil is available in several forms, including tinctures, capsules, concentrates, and topical forms, right? However, it is most commonly administered orally. Now, with depression, CBD oil may be taken in a tincture and capsule forms. Individuals with depression can begin with a dose of 5 to 10 milligrams daily until the desired results are achieved. Now, gel capsules of CBD are available at 25 milligrams per pill, and it is safe to begin at that dosage because I mentioned before, CBD is really safe, has really no toxicity. Now, the effects of CBD last several hours after taking, and most people say they feel better for up to 24 hours. However, if you will only begin to notice these improvements after 90 minutes of taking CBD oil. As with anything OTC, including supplements, etc., always talk to your doctor before starting anything like that, okay, guys? Mm. CBD oil, what do you do dosage-wise? You put like two little drops in your mouth and it's all good?
Yeah, sublingually, like I don't take it every day. I just take it like, I don't know, like once every couple of days to every week or so. And, you know, oftentimes it's like for sleep, actually, I've found it to be a really effective sleep aid because sometimes like I just can't go to sleep. So I take melatonin, I'll take a little CBD with it. Really awesome sleep. Like,
oh, yeah?
It'll probably work within like 30 minutes or something. And then I sleep really good and wake up the next morning and actually feel better. So,
so it helps calm you down then. Yeah, with sleeping.
It's like you're, you know, you have like running brain sometimes.
Of course,
like
we all have
it's
that.
So like, yeah, what it kind of does, it's like, boop. And you're like, ah, all right.
I like that, boop.
Yeah. And then all of a sudden, okay. That stopped. Now I can go to sleep. So it does definitely help with that.
So yeah, it's definitely effective. I think everything good about CBD. CBD is just good in general.
I'm
a strong proponent of CBD and marijuana in general. Anyways, so the next line of therapies that I want to look at is psychedelics and depression. Mm-hmm. Now, I mentioned before earlier in this episode, right? I did an audio on magic mushrooms back in the day. Audio 3, check it out. Let's look into why psychedelic drugs like psilocybin are getting attention as a potential treatment for depression, which is probably the bread and butter, and why its use is gaining more acceptance and popularity, right? So does psilocybin rewire the brain? Have you heard about that?
Have I heard about it?
Yes. So I run the research.
Listen.
What are you talking about?
Listen here. No, I'm very, very excited with where things are going. There's a region of the brain called the default mode network, and they theorize it to be our neurological ego center, or the center of our ego. So psilocybin reduces activity in the default mode network. And the relationship between depression and the default mode network is kind of complicated. It works a little bit similarly to the...
I heard about that, because the default mode network you mentioned, right? That's linked to depression, other mood disorders, if it's overactive, right?
Yeah.
Right? Okay.
Yeah, it's overactive, and like it kind of... There's this relationship with the connectivity of other brain regions, but there's a researcher at Imperial College London, Robert Carhart.
That's in London, you said?
Yeah. So they do the psilocybin stuff in London. Okay. And like he really thinks that one day psilocybin might replace SSRIs or antidepressants.
That'd be great. I mean, natural. It's mushrooms.
Yeah.
You know what? I was a dumb question, but it's like, I need to decipher, like, you know, we eat mushrooms, like, you know, saute some mushrooms and stuff. I need to decipher, like, what's regular mushrooms, what's like psilocybin mushrooms.
Yeah, you have like, to have guides. Mario, Super Mario World,
Nintendo?
The red and white mushrooms, they're based off of real, like, hallucinogenic mushrooms. So
That color, red and white?
Yeah, if you see those, you can eat them. It's just, it's not going to be, like, weird. So, they're called fly adamantia, but...
Interesting. That's interesting. So like you mentioned, though, like the DMN, which is a default mode network. So if it's overactive, that's bad. But magic mushrooms or psilocybin can reset that control system and reduce the activity at the DMN.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's what's really getting all this popularity and hoopla around magic mushrooms, because it can do that, which is really great.
Yeah. And oftentimes people only need one or two dosage. Like any sort of psychotropic medication should be used in conjunction with therapy. Mm. But the kinds of research that are being done, people are going in and only having like one or two dose sessions with the psilocybin, and the rest of the therapy is sort of centered around integrating that experience into their life. And they've oftentimes reported it as like one of the most meaningful experiences of their lives. And it like stays with them. That's not good for pharmaceutical companies, because they can't like make money off of it, like giving it to people over and over again. But, you know.
Funny you mentioned that, though. Magic mushrooms could be coming to a drugstore near you as a new depression medication, all right? Because a few months ago, the U.S. Food and Drug Administration, or FDA for short, I guess, announced it has granted the breakthrough therapy label to this pharma company called Compass Pathway, that's C-O-M-P-A-S-S Pathways, for his work in treating depressed patients with psilocybin. Now, this is huge, because the decision puts the drug on a fast track for additional studies that could eventually make prescription psychedelics a thing. And just to piggyback off that, there's a recent article I saw on CNBC, right, that stated that Walgreens will sell CBD creams, patches, and sprays in nearly 1,500 stores in select states, right? So the cannabis-based products are going to be sold in Oregon, Colorado, of course, because they're popping, New Mexico, Kentucky, Tennessee. I would never think it'd be Kentucky, Tennessee.
I know. Anyways,
Vermont. Yeah. Vermont. I can see Vermont, Colorado, Oregon so far.
Yeah.
South Carolina, I wouldn't think. Illinois, toss up. Indiana, definitely not.
Not Alabama.
Alabama is nowhere near any of this stuff. It will never be.
Yeah.
Alabama got other issues.
They don't deserve it.
They got other issues. Exactly, right? No. They got multiple issues to deal with in Alabama. Yeah. So if you go to Walgreens and live in those states, congratulations. All right. Now, Walgreens isn't the only place going to sell CBD, because CVS did introduce creams and ointments that contain CBD to stores in 8 states earlier this year in March.
Nice.
What do you think about that? That's cool, right? That should show you how less of a taboo marijuana in general is, because a lot of these companies are not getting involved with it, because they see it. Are they going to be involved with it, or are they going to get out of my way, because it's going to be there.
Yeah.
CBD is coming. Like, it's coming. Like, winter is coming, CBD is coming.
I feel like the general consensus is, like, you know, fucking legalize it. Like, there's no, like, reason not to. Like, it's...
I know it's all political, right? When it first got made illegal back in the day, right?
Yeah, and it would be safer, too. Like, when you have something that's available non-illegally, like, there are regulations you can actually control. You know, like, there's nothing that alcohol and tobacco hasn't done to people that marijuana could potentially do to other people. It kind of goes back to that, you know, the Reefer Madness?
That's what it was.
Exactly. Yeah, like, just Reefer these Madness. Horror stories. Yeah. So, you know.
Like, Colorado just made over, I'll talk about it later on, maybe my small dose episode after this one, but Colorado has made over $1 billion in revenue from that, and they're using it for good use to put it back into their school system.
Tax dollars.
Things like that.
Yeah.
Like, it's like, there's money here.
This is a win-win.
Win-win. Like, there's no reason, logical reason to not have it legalized, is what I'm saying.
Absolutely.
Put it that way, okay?
Yes.
ridiculous. But anyways, let's go on to probiotics now. The next topic of the discussion.
I love
probiotics and the gut bacteria. So we all may know that we have bacteria in our gut, right? There's good bacteria and there's bad bacteria based on what we eat, drink, et cetera, right? Now, there's evidence out there that the bacteria, also called microbes, in your gut can influence your mood and actually prevent depression. That's really dope.
Yeah.
Now, this one I thought was really cool, right? I thought that all bacteria in your gut was good for was to regulate like how often, you know, you visit your toilet. But there was a study of two large groups of Europeans which found that several species of gut bacteria are missing in people with depression.
Yeah, that's the same one that yeah. I was looking at, and I found that really interesting.
Isn't it?
Yeah, and then the other part of that study was saying that the depressed participants also had higher levels of bacteria associated with Crohn's disease, which is an inflammatory disorder.
Oh, so inflammation again leads to inflammation.
Exactly.
That's a key thing.
Yeah, so the idea that is possible, gut bacteria is becoming really popular in social science. Like, everybody's like, because they're finding really crazy shit.
Yeah.
Like, for example, there's a study at University of Maryland where they took the gut bacteria of people without schizophrenia and the gut bacteria of people with schizophrenia, and they were able to predict who had schizophrenia based on their gut bacteria.
Oh, wow.
That's, like, insane.
That's
like,
super dope.
Yeah. Like, especially when we don't understand stuff like schizophrenia very well. So it's becoming this huge thing. People are looking more into it. It's like, wow, the body's connected. Like, the idea of a
It's connected. We're definitely connected.
Yeah.
And like I said, it's early research, right? So they can't say whether it's the absence of the bacteria that's the cause or an effect of the illness. But they show that many gut bacteria could make substances that can affect nerve cell function and maybe mood, right?
Yeah.
It's called the microbiome brain connection, the MBC, not the station.
NBC. Not MBC.
like I mentioned before, it's a European study in Belgium with a group of participants, 173 to be exact, had been diagnosed with depression or had done poorly on a quality of life survey. And the researchers compared their gut bacteria with those of other participants. Now they found that two kinds of bacteria, the Coprococcus and the Dialister, were missing from the gut bacteria of the depressed patients, but not from those with a high quality of life.
Yeah.
They also found that the same results in another study, which involved Dutch participants, right? It's early too, right? But it seems to be that Coprococcus, the gut, whatever, seems to have a pathway related to dopamine, which is a key neurotransmitter involved with depression, all right? Yeah. But they still don't know how this might protect against depression. That same microbe, the Coprococcus microbe, right, also makes an anti-inflammatory, inflammation again, substance called butyrate, and increased inflammation of the substances implicated with depression. Now, probiotics help here because they can help to increase good bacteria and can decrease the number of bad bacteria in the gut that can cause infection and inflammation, right? Mm-hmm. So just in a related note, right, I saw a U.S. News and World Report the other day that basically said that your gut bacteria can affect your response to all types of medications. Not just like with depression, but all types of medications. So that's why you can see, right, when a patient, I mean, as far as me personally in the pharmacy, when a patient comes in and two patients are on the same medication, but one is on Synthroid, which is the brand name, and one is on levothyroxine, both help with your thyroid gland. And they're both basically the same thing, like same ingredients, everything. But one will work for one patient, one will work for the other patient, and that could be due to your gut bacteria. It's like no major big difference between a brand and generic, but a brand could work better for a particular patient and generics could work better for another patient. It's how it goes, right? So that's really cool. So
that is really the cool. Answer, I didn't even know
yeah,
that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. The answer is in your gut. I was doing a lot of research on this and I was finding out some great information. It's really dope.
You go into like freaking rabbit holes. Yeah. Like, I'm saying that, like, this is really cool. Yeah.
It's super dope.
Yeah.
Right? So your gut, guys, can affect like your depression. So watch what you eat out there. And maybe probiotics really is the way for the
fermented
future.
Fermented foods are the way to go. Something
really?
Else. Yeah. Going,
like what? Give me an example. What
kind of food kimchi, is? Sauerkraut, like, you know, stuff like that. They, there was something that I read that kind of goes back to what you were talking about, like with kids growing up in environments, food deserts, like in inner city environments where you can't get the type of food that's necessary for you to have healthy nutrition.
Yeah.
People in lower income areas
actually
don't eat as many fermented foods. And they found this like pretty consistent correlation between that and like higher rates of depression.
Oh, wow.
So it's like the idea that like, what we eat also influences whether or not we have those depressive symptoms.
Wow.
And like, you know, when you have a lack of nutrition, like that can kind of mess with your gut and then it like messes with your head. So
yeah, of course. And not only nutrition, like you know where your next meal is going to be at. That could cause like affecting you too.
Yeah.
Not knowing when the next meal is going to be at too when you grow up in that kind of environment.
Absolutely.
So that's super, super important to mention. That's good. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Let's talk about now ketamine and my depression. Favorite. This is your favorite one? Okay.
Second only to meth.
So, so most of you have probably heard of this drug in terms of being a club or party drug. Check out my last episode on Special K for more on that, which is party drugs, right? Mm-hmm. And some, right, may know that it's an anesthetic, which means they release pain, used on a battlefield or in operating rooms. But researchers at Yale are finding a new use for ketamine. They did a study and basically found that about 85% of the study participants that took ketamine got better, so less depression. Mm-hmm. How does it work, you say? So two ways people think. The first is that ketamine may target and bind receptors in the brain that increases the amount of a neurotransmitter called glutamate. Yeah. Then minus all that fancy science details, it ends up affecting your mood and how you think. Huh? And the second way, right, is that ketamine may reduce signals involved in inflammation. That word again. Inflammation is coming up everywhere.
Yes.
And that's linked to mood disorders. So ketamine is interesting because you see the results after it leaves the body. The researchers aren't sure why, but one theory is that ketamine helps connections between the brain cells that are involved in mood to regrow so that we get better connections, right?
That neuroplasticity.
Yeah, that's what I think so far. Yep. I don't know if you have anything else you want to say about this.
I actually have something great to tell you.
What do you have?
So Trump has been encouraging the VA to buy, and I quote, truckloads of a ketamine derivative called S-ketamine, brand name Spravato. It's probably the only rational thing he's ever done.
Oh, and I just feel,
once I'm like, you know what? You're not a complete piece of
shit.
Yes, there
he, yeah, he still is. But for that one move, he's not for that one move.
Like, I saw that and I was like, I'm proud of you.
But there's got to be an alternative reason for doing that anyway. I know it's an alternative reason. Maybe he has a friend at some pharmaceutical company that has that Spravato shit.
I can see him being
I can see that definitely be the reason. There's no way he has
He's
any...
He's like, I'm buying it for the vets, quote unquote, but really, I just need this while I'm watching Fox News. I'm just going to snort this.
Fox and Friends. So there's two main types of ketamine being used. You mentioned that one. I want to go back to that one, the Spravato. That's an IV infusion spray that's used off-label that goes to your bloodstream. It's been around for decades. But the second and most important one, I think, right, is the nasal spray you mentioned called Spravato, which is more into my pharmacy world. That was FDA approved in March, right? Mm. Right. Spravato is only part of the treatment for a person with depression, though. It's not the first-line treatment for depression. It's only prescribed for people with severe depression who haven't been helped by at least two other depression medications.
Treatment-resistant?
So you're not going to just go in there and just ask for Spravato. You have to have been on other things before. So I guess maybe eventually in the future they'll have it as a first-line therapy if it's seen in that regard. But right now, it's only if you haven't been good, I guess, off of other medication, then they'll recommend that for you.
That
but it's a nasal spray, right? And it was just really introduced back in March. So this year, brand new, 2019. So look out for that. So all this stuff is coming to market now that I mentioned before, too. All this psychedelic stuff and ketamine. Like, it's all coming, CBD. Like, we're going to be a whole new age of, how we treat ourselves. Like, all these medications
so
that we use now.
It's so,
isn't it super exciting?
We don't have SSRIs.
We're at the precipice of all this. Like, we're at the beginning right now. This is beautiful.
It's awesome. And this in conjunction with the Russians making quantum computers, it's like, no, oh, we're just my going goodness. Into space age.
And 5G networks coming up now.
God. It's going to be amazing.
Woo! So next up, we got ECT or electroconvulsive therapy.
Oh, man.
And depression. Oh, my God. So now, what's the first thing you think about when you hear that, ECT? I bet most people associate that with negative thoughts, and that is outdated, right? You see it in movies, the media, it's fun.
Yeah,
but
no, it's we're just going to provoke seizures in your brain.
I want to have an unbiased take on this one. I found a bias, maybe bias towards why it's good.
Yeah.
Right? They say that it's a painless medical procedure performed under general anesthesia, so you don't feel anything, apparently, right? And it's considered one of the most effective treatments for severe depression. It can be life-saving. For some people with severe or hard-to-treat depression, ECT, right, is the best treatment. Now, the main thing is that it works quickly because some people can wait 2, 4, 6 weeks for the antidepressants to kick in. Mm-hmm. Now, what do you think about that?
So it's funny because I've read similar things that you did, but the problem with it is it's effective for 50% of people who use it.
Okay.
And then the other 50%, it can have pretty.
So it's a toss up.
It really is. ECT. It really is. Well, because essentially you're just direct electrical currents. You're pretty much causing little seizures in your brain. So there have been people who've reported like, no, this was this act. If I hadn't done this, like I wouldn't be functional.
Exactly. Yeah.
You know, and I can understand like if it's a consensual choice, it's still technically used today. Real like a couple like old school psychiatrists use it. If it's something that you want to try and do and you're desperate, like, I totally get why. But, yeah. like, it's really...
Like, if everything else has failed, like, everything else has failed, and you ask your last option, okay, sure, you can't knock somebody for doing that. Yeah, do that, of course.
Exactly. Like, if that's your decision, like, you have the right to do that. There's another form of treatment called... transcranial magnetic stimulation.
Ooh,
and deep
big words.
Brain I know. But like really what it is, it's like a safer form of ECT. Like it's a little bit more focused because if you think of like, okay, you buzz this and like, electricity is going everywhere. And they've shown really good results again with that. So I'm not completely opposed to zapping brains. You know, it's just as long as it's done safely.
Yeah, because you mentioned before, like with the seizure stuff, like the electrical stimulation you get from ECT causes a brief seizure.
Yeah.
Right? There's no structural damage to the brain, but it's a brief seizure. And that seizure helps to relieve the symptoms of depression.
Right.
So you need a seizure to get less of the depression, then you have a seizure. Like, it's just, I don't know.
That's pretty crazy.
Like I said, like I think a last resort, if you have tried everything else and it's not working out, then, I mean, do what you got to do, bro.
Yeah, exactly.
And that's a good one there. Last but not least, we got insulin and depression. Now, when my guest first mentioned this to me, I was asked, like, what?
What?
I know most of you probably like, what? Right now, like, insulin, depression, and diabetes? What are you talking about? I had never heard of this association of possibility relationship with diabetes and depression ever in my life. So apparently, patients with type 2 diabetes are 2 to 3 times more likely to have depression than those without diabetes. Depression is the most common psychiatric disorder witnessed in the diabetes community. For people with depression or with diabetes, dealing with a lifelong condition and managing the risk of complications can be overwhelming, especially for newly diagnosed patients, right? So many diabetics struggle to cope with the requirements of taking meds and checking the blood sugar regularly. They can feel overwhelmed, right? Or unmotivated. Like, I'm not gonna do this every day. Some people gotta do it like 3 times a day. So they check, prick the skin, check the blood sugar, do this. Like, it's just overwhelming. It's a lot to do.
And like juvenile diabetes, you've been doing that since you were like
four. Oh, yeah. I had a friend that had juvenile diabetes in school. And it's like every time, doing like before lunch or like after lunch, you have to go to the little corner and do it all the time. I didn't understand what it was before because we were only like 7, 8, 9. And like, we were like young, whatever. But like,
yeah.
You gotta do it every day. And it was like a lot. It's a lot.
That's
you know?
Tough stuff.
Yeah. And like, a lot of the time, like when people are faced with tough events or conditions, they'll try to escape or deny their circumstances, right?
Yeah.
They try to minimize what's going on in their life or their health and what you're going through at that particular moment in your life. And that can cause symptoms of depression. So it's best to face your problems head on and then pretend that it's not there, in my opinion.
Really? But, briefly, I just want to... So apparently there was a miscommunication between us because when I said insulin therapy and depression, I was actually referring to the insulin coma therapy.
Oh,
Talk
about that. What is that?
I'll tell you. So basically back in like the 40s and 50s, they used to just put people in fucking comas by giving them massive dosages of insulin. It's fucked up.
This is more interesting. I like this.
Yeah, no, it was originally designed for like people with schizophrenia. I remember because I was, you know, a little goth kid. So, of course, I had to read Sylvia Plath's The Bell
Jar. Goth Life, gang gang.
Yeah, gang gang. And, like, she like, described her treatment. And I just remember, like, my eyes just going, it literally fucks. I mean, it fucks up your body.
So, what happens? They put you in a coma and, like.
They give you so much insulin, you go into a coma. And for some reason, they decided that that was going to treat mental illness. It was very ineffective. It just ended up messing up a lot of people. And in the 1960s, they stopped doing it. But I don't know, like when I read about that, it reminded me of like leeching and, you know, all of the lobotomies and all that other stuff. But they did use it sort of off label for depression.
It
was primarily used for schizophrenia, but apparently depressed patients would do it and they gain an excessive amount of weight.
I was going to say, did it even work though for some people?
As far as I could tell, like it didn't really work for them. And it killed some people.
I mean,
apparently. That's not a solution.
Yeah, can you imagine all the things we used to do back in the day, all the therapies?
It's
like,
so crazy.
This is wild. We used to treat, it used to be cocaine and drinks and shit. Like,
you got ghosts in your blood. Might as well do cocaine about it.
Might as well. I got to cut cocaine, treat that right up.
Absolutely.
Or meth.
Yes.
So, anyways, as you can imagine, right, this is all new. So, there's not like a lot of information about, you know, diabetes, insulin, and depression, all that good stuff. But right now, it's understood that there are 3 mechanisms that link the brain insulin resistance with major depression.
Mm, But see, this is interesting. This is stuff I didn't look up.
See, that's good, right?
Yeah.
For the most part, people that end up with type 2 diabetes do not have a healthy lifestyle, right? In general, in terms of like eating healthy, exercising, right?
Yeah.
Don't want to judge anybody, but that's just what it is. So I wanted to bring that up because I think it's interesting. I mean, not all diabetic patients are overweight or unhealthy, but a good majority are, and I can't help but think that it's more of a way of life, or is it insulin? I'm not trying to be controversial. I'm just saying because research has shown that people that stick to healthy behaviors have been able to reduce insulin sensitivity that kind of lessens your depressive symptoms, right? And research also shows that although it's not a treatment, physical exercise has been shown to improve depressive symptoms. So get out there, exercise, eat healthier, and maybe that will help with depression a little bit.
Yeah.
Right? Now, also not sure if you can speak to this or not, but antidepressants like SSRIs, which are meds like Prozac or Zoloft, can cause hypoglycemia, which is low blood sugar, which can make someone clumsy and confused and have difficulty talking. So you can imagine like limits to therapies for diabetic patients who have depression. Like, what are you supposed to do for treatment? Because if you take if they're depressed and take an SSRI, that can cause them hypoglycemia. So it's like, what do they have?
Well, yeah, it's like if you're already kind of struggling with, for instance, carbohydrate cravings or sugar cravings, like that's just going to kind of intensify it.
Yeah.
So that really kind of, see that they should, that psilocybin, there psilocybin. You go, CBD.
Like that's the answer. That's the answer for everything.
Psilocybin, you won't have diabetes no more, depression anymore, you'll be fine. It'll work out really good.
All right, that was good. That was good. I like that discussion. That was a good discussion.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now I want to switch gears and talk about rumor versus truth, all right? It's everybody's favorite part. Now, I was trying to look for some facts about, you know, depression, this, that, and a third, but I just going to give a kind of a general rumor versus truth this time, okay?
Okay.
The first one, you tell me if it's rumor or truth, okay?
Okay.
The first one I want to say is depression is all in your head. Rumor or truth?
Rumor. I say rumor.
Explain, por favor.
Because the mind and body are holistic. The gut biome and the brain are connected via the hypothalamic pituitary axis.
Oh, and you're throwing out big words now.
Yeah. But it's this thing that sends hormones down there and up here. And it's like a feed. It's like a rubber band.
Yeah,
it,
you know, it's a feedback loop kind of thing.
Exactly. Yeah. Like, I feel like if it was all in our heads, then we wouldn't be able to do physical exercise to kind of help us with it.
Well, technically, this is true. Everything you said was all correct, first off, right? But depression is all in the head of the depressed person. But just not in the way it's like, get over it in a way. Like
right,
that, okay?
Right.
Their brain is functioning differently than an average person, right? Mm. And their thoughts will be more negative due to biological and environmental factors, okay? So it's kind of on to say it's like, it go both ways on that one, okay,
guys?
Yeah,
I can see your side too.
You know what I mean? That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Okay, controversy. Depression is due to laziness.
Rumor? No.
Explica.
That sounds like something that you tell yourself when you're having a depressive episode. And it's like, that's sort of like a chicken or egg thing. It's like, okay, it's negative self-talk. Is that causing the depression or is it a result of the depression? You know, it's like, you're lazy. You're not picking up those whole things of like, you know, I have dishes in my sink and I need to like clean them, but I'm lazy.
I think you're right about it. Yeah.
Yeah.
So like symptoms of depression include lack of energy, right? Lack of interest in pleasurable activities and lack of motivation.
Which
can be interpreted as that. Yeah. But these symptoms will look like laziness, but in reality is the question of what came first, right? Chicken or the egg.
Yeah.
So in this case, depression is the cause of the effect.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it's like, that's a tough one, man, because the symptoms of the laziness are similar to depression. It's like, anyways, next one. Depression is totally hereditary.
Oh, absolutely rumor. Mm? Absolutely rumor. Yeah, yeah. Okay. Life events, there are environmental factors. Like, everything interacts with each other.
Absolutely.
Depression has a really strong genetic component. I mean, you have, like, certain families. For example, Ernest Hemingway, like, his grand, who had ECT. Which didn't work for him.
ECT therapy?
Yeah, he did, and then committed suicide and all that. But his father, people in his family did, and his granddaughter did. You have like these families where it's like multiple
hereditary
suicide stuff, so they might have more of a stronger genetic component.
Yeah.
But then you can have other people, it's like they come from perfectly fine backgrounds, but just find themselves like really
struggling. Life takes its toll on them, I guess.
And it's crazy, like the disparity of
that,
you know? Yeah.
Wow, that's very interesting. You get it either way.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there is a genetic link, but doesn't mean that you're guaranteed to have depression. Just right. one of the factors. So about 10% of Americans will experience a depressive episode in their life. Mm-hmm. And if you have a parent with depression, it'll be a 20 to 30% chance of developing depression.
Yeah.
So you have a higher likelihood, but you're not like as prone to it. Like
totally.
You're guaranteed, okay?
Yeah.
So you're more likely to not experience depression at all.
Yeah.
Next one. If you're sad, you're depressed.
I would say rumor. You have to fit the DSM diagnostic criteria for a depressive disorder. So I don't know. Yeah.
No, that's true. Yeah. So a lot of times people like can equate depression with sadness, but that's like saying a hurricane is the same as a windy day.
Yeah.
Like apples and oranges, right?
Depression. Like I'm traumatized because I can't find my keys.
Yeah, exactly. Like Carol, depression. Yeah. Depression is multifaceted, right?
Yeah.
And multidimensional. Mm-hmm. And actually some people don't feel sad at all during a period of depression. I found that out, which is very interesting.
What is it? I can't remember the term of it, but it's like inability to experience emotions, which funny enough, men experience more than women because men are socialized not to really be. Yeah. So.
Yeah. We're socialized not to have like emotional, like, well, I completely agree with that.
Yeah.
1000%.
Yeah.
The next rumor versus truth. Medication is the solution. It's all I need to be better. That's all I need. Give me some pills.
That is a rumor. Studies have shown that the most effective treatment for depression is a combination of medication and therapy together.
All right. So medication is not an absolute cure for depression. Like, duh. So if you're depressed and you get medication for it, don't think it's a magic pill and you're going to be all better. Some people will actually respond well to their meds, while others will find it no difference in the symptoms whatsoever.
Yeah.
So like things like exercise and eating healthy, pleasurable experiences, and CBT, which is cognitive behavioral therapy, it's all needed to really have a positive effect
social
in helping.
Social support,
everything.
Yeah.
It takes a village.
Yeah.
With everything, okay? It's not just you by yourself popping pills.
Fuck yeah, Twitter.
Exactly, Twitter hashtags, like people talk about a depression.
Yeah.
Next one. People with depression just lay on the couch feeling sad.
No, I would say rumor. I mean, I do when I'm sad. I like to do that.
I think we all do when we're sad. Yeah. Put on some pajamas, eat some ice cream, going through a breakup, everything like that. You know, things like that.
Yeah.
It all happens, you know?
I think there's levels of functioning to depression.
Yeah.
And the functionality key, that component's really important because some people might not even realize that they're depressed. You know, if you don't really, like, if you're not feeling anything, if you're not feeling sad, how do you even know, you know?
Absolutely. Absolutely. This one's really interesting because, like, we all deal with different things in different ways, and depression is no different. There's no universal type of depression, and many times, like I mentioned before, with the DSM-5 criteria, right? Some people will still be able to be energetic, you said, energetic and motivated despite the depression.
Yeah.
They can still be energetic, motivated, all that good stuff, right? Which allows them to appear not symptomatic, right?
Right.
Basically, they show no symptoms of depression, like I mentioned before, right, to the people in their lives. But others will present with higher levels of irritability and agitation, right, rather than depression. So which can make people think that they're angry rather than depressed.
Yes. Men especially are more prone
absolutely.
To anger. Shows as depression, and it can be really difficult to kind of understand. Yeah.
Maybe they're just depressed and they can't reveal it, you know?
It's
tough.
Because the patriarchy affects men, too. It's like, okay, it's only socially acceptable for boys to express anger. That kind of it causes a lot of men to feel like they're in sort of like a binding pattern. It's like, it's not safe for me to
no way out.
That.
They can't escape. They just
exactly.
feel trapped in that, and they have to be angry. That's how they show. That's how they feel like they have to get it out. All the energy they have with the depression, just release it through the anger.
Yeah, like Bell Hooks said, feminism is for everybody.
Yeah,
so,
I'm a feminist. Strong feminist right here.
Same.
Gang, feminist.
Gang.
last but not least, tests can diagnose you with depression. Tests. Keyword there, tests.
What type of tests? Can you say that or no?
Yeah, like objective test, like any kind of test, like objective data test, like tests can diagnose you.
Yeah, they do have some psychometric tools that assist in diagnosing depression.
Oh, yeah? It's not just the DSM-5 criteria?
Not just the DSM-5 criteria. They're part of larger, like they have these like freaking huge personality tests that you can take. I think one of them is like the Minnesota Multiphasic Personality Inventory.
Ooh.
I know. Another big word here. All that means is like, listen, we're going to ask you a bunch of shit and tell you how fucked up you are. So it's like really big. And I think one of the components of that is depressive symptoms. But
Well, when I was looking up this stuff, whatever, I found that they said there was no definitive test to diagnose someone with depression. And that makes sense, right?
That definitive test.
Like, there's no urine or blood test yet.
Oh,
maybe?
God, yeah.
Yeah, like to show your depression.
Or anything. Oh, yeah, I totally agree with that. I thought, I was thinking more of like psych, you know, know, psychological screens and stuff.
Like, can you imagine like, doctor comes in the office? Oh my God, your urine smells horrible.
Your urine you is have so depression. Depressed.
You got some depressed urine there. Like, no. So, like, those surveys you take on your computer, or, like, generate questionnaires or whatever, it's not where the answer is going to be at, okay?
Yeah.
Like, only a trained mental health expert can actually make the diagnosis based on your symptoms, right? The length of your symptoms, all that kind of stuff, all the factors in your life, okay? It's really a judgment call based on those symptoms, right? They'll say whether you have it or not.
Yeah.
There's no real definitive test for it.
Yep.
Well, that was good.
That was great.
Yeah, right? You had some good information right there.
You
appreciate
did
that.
Too. And I feel like this is a good collaborative effort.
Wasn't it?
Yes.
All right. Well, I want to say thank you for my guests, first off. And thank you guys for listening. I hope you were entertained and learned a few things. Remember to like and follow my Facebook page. That's Druggy Nation, Drug-E Nation, right on Facebook. The link is in my Instagram bio. Just search for my name, which is Emmanuel, Emmanuel underscore Woghiren. And subscribe, all right, on Apple Podcasts, on Spotify, or Podbean. And leave a comment. It would be great to hear some feedback from you guys, okay? And also listen, guys, together with your friends and your family and see how they react to each episode. And let me know what you want to hear my guests and I talk about. You can DM me on IG or send a message on a podcast Facebook page and just use the hashtag DrugEtopics, hashtag D-R-U-G-E topics, okay? And I'll definitely take a look at that, all right? And we'll make it happen. Again, thanks for listening, guys. It's only going to get better. Melissa, you have any shout-outs you want to say? I know you like rap music. What's your favorite rap artist right now?
What
are you listening to?
Logic, because you just like roasted.
Oh, no. Logic is cool. Jenny likes Logic too.
Actually,
Logic's cool,
I like Cup Kake. She's my favorite.
What is it called?
Cup Kake.
Cup Kake. Spell that for us, please.
C-U-P-C-A-K-K-E. I don't know if you fuck with Kai as my neck, my back. She makes that bitch look like Girl Scout cookies.
Wait, are you serious?
Yeah, she's my favorite.
Okay.
I mean, Lil Nas X is great. Old Town Road
is just a classic. I love the remake. It's a banger. It's definitely a banger.
But thank you. I really enjoyed being on this.
So remember to subscribe on Apple Podcasts, Podbean app, and Spotify. It's on Stitcher. It's everywhere. Pretty much get your podcast fixed, okay? And today's quote I leave you with is, you are enough, you have enough, and you do enough. And remember that mental illness is not a personal failure, okay? Mental illness is not a personal failure. You are enough. It's still RIP to Nipsey the Great. The marathon continues. Remember, subscribe on all those platforms I mentioned so you can get automatic notifications when new episodes drop. And also, just a friendly reminder to check out my Small Doses series. So don't forget to check it out. On the next episode, we're talking about Alzheimer's disease and some other recent interesting health news. So check that out. Again, thanks for listening, guys. Only gonna get better. And with that, I'm out.
Was it okay?
Perfect.
Yay!